Good morning.
Good morning.
I invite you to quiet your hearts and minds as we prepare for worship by listening to our choir anthem, Majesty. Good morning.
Good morning.
I have misplaced my announcement, so we're going to wing it. It is so good to be here with all of you today on our 85th anniversary here at Bethany. It is a great joy to have you all with us, and I cannot wait to celebrate today. We have birthdays this week, and I only remember one of them off the top of my head because it's today. Martha Rimothy's birthday is today. Woo! And there are other birthdays, so I invite you to look at our birthday list out in the narthex when you're headed out today so that you can see who has a birthday this week and who you might want to reach out to. Next up, update on our coat drive. We were able to donate a very large trash bag full and two large bins fulls of coats to Epworth's Bread of Life food pantry so that they can give them out to the winter. So that is very good. They have a huge amount of coats over there that are being handed out. So thank you all for your generosity there. The next update is in regards to our food drive, where we were trying to get 500 food items by the end of October. We have gathered 591 plus food items already, so congratulations. Thank you all for your generosity. As a reminder, scouting for food will be beginning shortly, so please continue to bring in donations, bring in monetary donations or food donations, whichever you prefer. The food bank will be grateful for everything that they receive because, as Bill told me, they served over 165 families yesterday and almost ran out of prepackaged bags. So there is a great need at the moment, and so it is our joy to be able to help contribute to this. Also, at the end of our service, if you didn't know, we're having a celebration today for our 85th anniversary. So for those of you who who are coming to that, please know that you do not need to rush over there. The event begins at noon, so feel free to meander over to the clubhouse at the Palmyra Harbor. Spend some time here talking to people, chatting with people you might not have seen in a while, and then meander over there. If you get there before me, we are not eating until I pray. So even if you get there before me, you're not going to get anything yet. So all of that is happening. Do we have any other announcements that we know I'm forgetting? Okay. If there are, I'll announce them later once I find my paper. Yeah.
My granddaughter Gabby got a driver's license. Woo-hoo!
Thank you. Also, we welcome Pastor Dean Brown from the Synod office, who is with us here to represent the Synod. Bishop Bartholomew could not join us. She is a very, very, very busy woman. But Pastor Brown is here to be with us. He will be preaching this morning. And any of you kids in the congregation, he'll invite you up for a children's message later, okay? Don't worry, it's easy. So with all of that, I invite you to rise as you're able as we begin our service with the order of confession and forgiveness of sins as found on page 95. One God, who forgives all our sin and whose mercy endures forever.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Gracious God,
have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves into the power of sin. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done, and things we have failed to do. Turn us again to you, and uphold us by your Spirit, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin, and made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. May Almighty God strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith.
Amen.
We continue with our gathering hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness, hymn number 733.
Thank you.
act for your glory, redeemed by you. Let us give you what is yours. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. I invite you to be seated for the readings.
Good morning.
Good morning.
First reading is Isaiah 45, verses 1 through 7. Thus says the Lord to his anointed into Cyrus, whose right hand I have grasped to subdue nations before him and strip kings of their robes, to open doors before him, and the gates shall not be closed. I will go before you and level the mountains. I will break in pieces the doors of the bronze and cut through the bars of iron. I will give you the treasures of the darkness and the riches hidden in secret places, so that you may know that it is I, the Lord, the God of Israel, who call you by your name. For the sake of my servant Jacob and Israel my chosen, I call you by your name, to surname you, though you do not know me. I am the Lord, there is no other. Besides me, there is no God. I arm you, though you do not know me, so that they may know from the rising of the sun and from the west that there is no one besides me. I am the Lord, and there is no other. I form the light and create darkness. I make weal and create woe. I, the Lord, do all these things. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
We'll do the Psalm 96 responsibly. Sing the Lord a new song. Sing the Lord, all the earth.
Sing to the Lord, bless the name of the Lord. Proclaim God's salvation from day to day.
Declare God's glory among the nations and God's wonders among all peoples.
For great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised, more to be feared than all gods.
As for all the gods of the nations, they are but idols, but you, O Lord, have made them. Made the heavens.
Majesty and magnificence are in your presence. Power and splendor are in your sanctuary.
Ascribe to the Lord, you families of the peoples. Ascribe to the Lord honor and power.
Ascribe to the Lord the honor due the holy name. Bring all praise and enter the courts of the Lord.
Worship the Lord in beauty of holiness. Tremble before the Lord, all the earth.
Tremble down among the nations. The Lord is King, the one who made the world so firm that it cannot be moved, will judge the peoples with their equity.
Let the heavens rejoice, and let the earth be glad. Let the sea thunder, and all that is in it. Let the field be joyful, all that is in there, therein.
The kings of all trees of the wood shout for joy at your coming, Lord, for you come to judge the earth.
You will judge the world with righteousness and the peoples with your truth. The second reading is Thessalonians 1 through 10. Paul, Silvanus, and Timothy to the church of the Thessalonians and God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, grace to you and peace. We always give thanks to the Lord, always give thanks to God for all of you and mention you in our prayers. Constantly, remembering before our God and Father your work of faith and labor of love and steadfastness of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. For we know, brothers and sisters, we love by God, that he has chosen you, because your message of the gospel came to you, and in a word only, but also in power and in the Holy Spirit and with conviction, just as you know what kind of person we proved to be among you for your sake. And you became imitators of us and of the Lord. For in spite of the persecution, you received the word with joy inspired by the Holy Spirit, so that you became an example to all believers in Macedonia and Achaia. For the word of the Lord has sounded forth from you not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but in every place where faith in God has become known, so that we may have no need to speak about it. For the people of those regions report about us what kind of welcome we had, and among you, and you have turned to God from the idols to serve as a living and true God, and to wait for his Son for the heaven, whom he raised from the dead. Jesus, who rescues us from the wrath, is coming. Here ends the reading.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise as you're able for the gospel.
According to St. Matthew, the 22nd chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
The Pharisees went and plotted to entrap Jesus in what he said. So they sent their disciples to him, along with the Herodians, saying, "Teacher, we know that you are sincere and teach the way of God in accordance with truth, and show deference to no one, for you do not regard people with partiality. Tell us then what you think. Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not?" But Jesus, aware of their malice, said, "Why are you putting me to the test, you hypocrites? Show me the coin used for the tax." And they brought him a denarius. And then he said to them, "Whose head is this, and whose title?" They answered, "The emperor's." Then he said to them, "Give therefore to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's." When they heard this, they were amazed, and they left him and went away. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. And though I am a stranger, yes, Reverend Dean Brown, I'm not here all the time. Oop, I'm going to put that back over there. I'd like to see, are there any children who would come forward for a children's sermon? Well, come on down. My name is Pastor Dean. What's your name? Isabel? Nice to see you, Isabel. Oh, I love your shoes. They're so pretty.
I'll come up, too, just so we know people.
Did you want to sit down, honey? Good. Well, it's good to see you, Isabel. Oh, look at this. A whole bunch of people. Come on down. It's an altar call. Good to see you. Good to see you. Thanks for coming down. Nice. Hey, what's going on? How are you? I like your suspenders. Cool braces. So my name is Pastor Dean. And like Pastor Bree, I used to serve a church, but now I serve something called synod. Can you say that word with me? Synod?
Synod.
Very good, Isabel. Excellent. It's a word you don't hear a lot except in the church. And what synod means is it means a collection of churches just like this one. Jesus is calling them. It means a collection of churches just like this one working together to bring love and kindness into the world the way Jesus asks us to. We hear that Sunday in and Sunday out, that Jesus was sent by God and brought love and kindness and togetherness in this world. And so this church does this, and yet we do even more of it together with all of our churches. You know, just a little bit ago, before the reading I read, Mr. Rick read a letter that was sent to a congregation. And do you know the way that letter starts? It starts by saying, "Everybody has heard about the good that you are doing." This person named St. Paul said that. And do you know what? People still say things like that about the church. People say things like that about your church, because this church and you do good things in the name of Jesus Christ. So, guess what I get to do in my job? I get to say thank you. Thank you so much for what you do to show the kind of love that Jesus Christ had, the kind of love that God has to a world that wants it so much. Good for you. Good for you for being here, and good for this church for welcoming you here. Can we say a prayer together? So what you do is, I call this proper prayer position. We take our hands and we fold them together, and then we close our eyes. It helps us concentrate. And now I'm going to pray. Almighty God, we give you thanks for the gifts of your Spirit, your all-encompassing love. We give you thanks for these children here. Help them to grow up strong in the faith you have given them, knowing that they are forever your children and that they are ambassadors of your love in creation through this church and whatever other church they're a part of together. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let's try that one more time. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks
be to God. Thanks for coming up. Good to see you. You can take your seats again.
Pastor Bree, I think I have your bulletin.
Do you?
Oh, maybe not.
I don't know.
Bulletin's lying all over. Yes, so my name is Reverend Dean Brown, and as I shared just now, and Pastor Bree introduced me at the beginning, I get to serve as one of your assistants to the bishop, and I've gotten to know you as recently this church was in a call process, and we walked, literally, you and me walked together in synod and have arrived at this glorious time. It is great to be here with you, especially on this occasion where you're celebrating your 85 years of ministry. Pastor Bree handed to me the official copy of your 85th anniversary booklet. Thank you for that gift. It's sitting right there. I got to look at the draft, and I just found it thrilling to look over it. I hope if you haven't reviewed that booklet yet, you take a look at that and notice the span of time that this church has been here, the history that this church has traveled across, and all the good that wasn't easy or perfect, probably, and probably mistakes along the way too, but all the goodness of Jesus Christ that you have received and that you have been able to bear unto others. Pray with me now, will you? Almighty God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable unto you. Amen. So has it ever happened to you? I know that it has happened to me. Have you ever been asked a question that you knew wasn't really the question being asked? Truth is, bravo if you knew this ahead of time. Because if you did, then you would choose what to say and not to say, not solely on the merit of the question, but on the merit of the environment in which it was asked, or by responding or not to the deeper issue which is actually seeking to be addressed, the actual question behind the question, judgment behind the question. Oftentimes these questions, do you believe this or do you believe that? Oftentimes these either or questions are asked, they are asked in complete sincerity, are asked in environments of deep trust and mutuality. I love when people of faith like us can gather and deeply reflect on some of the recurring questions of faith, what it is to live baptized, questions that we rarely, if ever, are the first ones to ask, yet natural and enduring questions which present themselves again and again for every age, every generation to consider, probe, be curious about. All this with the benefit of possessing, as Lutherans, a rich theological, historical tradition, a gift to guide us and help us in our pursuit to heed Christ's call, follow me. Right? That's what Jesus says in this gospel to Matthew the tax collector. Follow me. But other times and in other circumstances these either or questions. Is the Bible the authoritative word of God or not? When were you saved? How is one saved? What does salvation mean? Isn't doubt the opposite of faith and therefore to be renounced, denied, and avoided? In other times and in other circumstances, these questions may be asked to form a quick profile, to perform a reductive assessment, or sometimes even more unfortunately, the question is posed as a pretext to smear, if not entrap, another due to some ulterior or perhaps subconscious motive. This is the type of question we have today in our gospel. This is the type of question that is being posed to Jesus in the story I just read to you. What do you think? Jesus is asked. Is it lawful to pay taxes or not? We hear in that text, specifically, that this was not a sincere question. St. Matthew writes, the disciples of Pharisees and Herodians went and plotted to entrap Jesus. We also know that this question was not posed in good faith. No, rather, it was one of those, the enemy of my enemy is my friend scenarios. In other words, you had two groups that normally would not cooperate on anything. That is, the Herodians were friendly towards Roman rule, while the Pharisees absolutely were not. And you had these two adversaries temporarily suspending their misgivings to form this momentary alliance. And so here is Jesus, not unlike so many other times, being cross-examined. Sure, it was couched in flattery. You clearly hear this friendly faith talk on the surface, but friendly faith talk, it absolutely was not. And like so many times before, go to the beginning of the gospel. Like at the beginning, throughout Jesus' temptation in the wilderness, lots of either or questions to entrap Jesus there, Jesus is faced again with one of these either or lines of inquiry, a manufactured moment with the sole purpose of discrediting Jesus, if not then and there leading to his arrest. But you see, that is what is so unique and special about this story. Jesus understands all too well the motives beneath the question. It explains his mysterious response, give to the emperor what are the emperor's and to God what are God's. It explains this response that both addresses the question and on purpose evades it, but then an answer that goes far beyond what the interlocutors even imagined. And on this day, you see, what I think is so meaningful for us is how it is a witness, a reminder of the type of life Jesus seeks for us to know, practice, believe, trust, share. You see, we are not an either-or people. To be sure, tautologies, simple maxims, and sharp dichotomous thinking are an aspect of our humanity. They creep into our daily discourse now and again, but they are not the totality of our being, at least not as revealed by God in Jesus Christ. No, you see, we are. God has made us through faith in Christ, through baptism. We are not an either-or people. We are a becoming people. We are people who God has mercifully chosen to love. And we are a people being formed in that mercy, on our way yet not having fully arrived yet. We are a people being formed, not there, on the way, being formed in the image of God. More flow, if you will, than end point. More kind of trajectory than final destination or finished product. And you know the interesting thing about that? Not one of us, not one of us does this alone. God has given you and me to each other. We need one another. We rely on one another. We are God's gifts to one another. I think that is absolutely one of the great lessons of this day. Though some party showed up to exploit easy divisions, Jesus doesn't fall for it. He finds a way to remain in communion, in fellowship with his disciples, and frankly, any sincere onlookers, people seeking meaning, connection, healing, belonging. And Jesus found a way to stay focused on this more profound mission, God's mission, to redeem a lost and lonely world. Bethany Evangelical Lutheran Church, I believe this has been your mission. This has been an aspect of your 85 plus. You didn't start in 1938, really, right? You had to put a few years before that in your write-up. This has been an aspect of your 85 plus years of faith and life together. And can we say thanks be to God for that?
Thanks be to God for that?
Okay, I know how you talked about it, or I saw those ways you wrote about it in your Bethany Evangelical Lutheran Church 85th Anniversary book. Let's say that 10 times fast. You wrote about the early days of what it was like trying to start a church before, oh my goodness, before and following a depression. I mean, just pause on that one a second. You wrote about what now, not the moment probably, but now, are funny memories. I love this one. Like the time two coffee pots were plugged in by a well-meaning member, it was inserted, for post-worship coffee hour, only to result in, I guess, a fuse blew. And so the organ stopped playing and you finished without the cappella music. The cookies were good, I heard. You wrote about ecumenical relationships locally being formed for the sake of the gospel, bringing God's loving kindness into this world. You wrote about changes in, oh my goodness, communion practice, going from wafers to home-baked bread, and it sounded like something like moving from individual cups to adding the common cup. You shared memories of members who were generous to the church beyond the grave, benefiting the church to this day. You wrote about all that and absolutely so much more. I'm sorry if I left out your favorite kernel. But really, right? It's not in the bullet points, but really, what you were doing, really, you were becoming the baptized people of God that was God was calling forth in you. In you. To be. Sure. I mean, I know. Imperfections. That's why I love Lutheranism. We don't put on this fallacy that we are so perfect. Sure, with imperfections, but Also, so much beauty. God's beauty in you. Showing up in the life of what you are doing for one another. Showing up alongside one another. And not only for one another, but those ways that it would cascade beyond these walls into your neighborhood. And I would argue, I have argued and continue to argue, that this type of ministry, that kind of work, that kind of fellowship, though it is not always found on the front pages of a newspaper, I know I dated myself, or I'm going to be hip now, or what may easily be conveyed in a social media post, keep those up. It is one of the most essential, right? I mean, this way of being together, this way of becoming baptized, it is one of the most essential and holy ways you have lived out and continue to live out Christ's life given and shared with you. And not only you, but through you and to your community, your neighbors who have just such a need, and to this world. We are a becoming people. We are a people being formed into the image of God, not having arrived, on our way, and we do this together, being a caring community, bringing hope, sharing laughter and tears, space for healing lament, inexpressible joy, and through it all, puncturing the loneliness so many of us live with, and in place of that, injecting sacred community, the opportunity for belonging we all and this world does so deeply crave. Community that is transformative, seen sometimes, other times not as noticeable, but in the Spirit of God always, always there. Long ago, a certain crowd sought to interrogate, even entrap Jesus. Jesus instead revealed a third way, a becoming way, a way that fortified community, a way that ultimately led to God's redemption of God's creation. Thanks be to God. Thanks be to God for the life of God found here, and thanks be to God for the people that you are, that Christ has made you, for the ministry that you have done and that continues and that is being discerned for tomorrow. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.
I invite you to rise as you're able as we continue with our hymn of the day. Give thanks with a grateful heart, which you will find on the back of your bulletin.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated for prayer.
Trusting in the transformative power of God's holy, loving Spirit, let us pray for the church, the world, and all in need. Faithful God, your Spirit animates the church throughout the world and binds believers near and far into the body of Christ. Equip us with the work of faith and enlarge our hearts to the labor of love. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Created God, the sea roars, the earth rejoices, and the heavens are glad at the wonder of all you have made. Bless the work of ecologists and conservationists, and all those who safeguard the riches of creation. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Sovereign God, your rule and authority is over the cosmos. As you once worked through the ruler Cyrus for the good of the people, accomplish your purposes through the work of the elected leaders and public servants. Guide them with your wisdom and compassion. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Caring God, your arms enfold all who are lonely, oppressed, despairing, sick, and suffering. Today, especially, we pray for Phyllis Hess, Linda Patton, Melva Beckler, Jim and Ruth Ellen Chaney, Erna Bauer, Steve Kurdish, Stephen Moore, Mitchell Blessio, Julie Kohler, Diane Drevey, Angeline Arali, Kenny Flack, Teresa Patterson, Peterson, Frank Sarcombe, Ellen Conroy, Elsie Hoffman, Judy Evans, and the family and friends of Elaine Stinnett. Pour out your abundant mercy on all whom this world has neglected and abandoned and forgotten, that they all may know your joy. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Almighty God, all our life belongs to you. When the earthly idols threaten to lead you with the church astray, remind us that you are alone and are the source of our eternal hope. Direct the work of the church, treasurers, councils, and all who manage financial matters. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
We give thanks to you for the members and the ministry of this congregation, for those who have had vision to begin this congregation, those who sustain its present ministry, and those who will carry its mission forward into the future. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Everlasting God, the saints of every age have sung your praise and shared your word. We give you thanks for their witness and pray that we may join them as citizens of their unending kingdom. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Gracious God, into your hands we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your unending love and amazing grace through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. I invite you to rise if you're able. At this time, we're going to pray for the 85th anniversary. Let us pray. O God, you have promised through your Son to be with your church forever. We give you thanks for those who founded this community of believers and for the signs of your presence in our congregation. Increase in us the spirit of faith and love, and make our fellowship an example to all believers and to all nations. We pray this through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
I invite you to share a sign of Christ's peace with those around you. I now invite you to please be seated for the offering.
Thank you.
gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. Communion today will take place around the altar rail. Please come forward at the direction of the ushers, kneel or stand as you desire, and receive the bread from me and either wine or grape juice from our communion assistant. If you would like to receive communion at your seat, please just let one of the ushers know and we will bring it to you. Regardless of where you are in your faith journey, all are welcome to take part in this feast which God has laid out before us. This is Christ's table, prepared for all people. If you would not like to receive communion, you are invited to come forward for a blessing. Just cross your arms over your chest like so I don't try and hand you bread many times. And so with all of that, taste and see that the Lord is good. Thanks be to God. Please rise as you're able. May the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. We will now sing, "Now, Lord, you let your servant go in peace." Amen. We continue with our second.